Well, hi Leo, and thank you so much for joining us today to talk a little bit about the track that you teach here at UCR. You teach physics, right?
I do, yes.
All right. So can you tell me a little bit about the kinds of courses that a student can expect to take within the physics track?
Of course, Denise. Like all tracks, you know, we have a bit of a build-up, of course. We have introductory courses and then build up to some of the higher levels. We have the most commonly taken first year course is Introduction to Physics, which really is about mechanics, and that it means describing motion of objects, whether it's under the influence of gravitational forces or other forces. It's about rotations, it's about oscillations. It's basically a standard course that I think worldwide any student, physics student in their first year would probably take. There also is a first year course which really is focused on astronomy, and that one is taught by my colleague Andrew Brooks. And that course is obviously focused more on astronomy, a different topic. It also is a little bit designed to be a bit more open to students from other disciplines, even for non-science discipline. It's a bit less mathematical, perhaps I can say. In my courses, calculus was invented to do mechanics, so I do feel that that should be part also of the physics course. That's how we start. Then in the second year's course, they alternate actually. Right now, later today, I'm going to teach a course in quantum mechanics. A year from today, I will be teaching the electromagnetism course.
Right.
They're both intermediate level courses. Quantum mechanics is about the behavior of molecules, atoms, objects at really small scale. The world looks very different when you're talking about atomic or subatomic scales. It's not all like, billiard balls or cars moving around the track. The world is very different there, but quite fascinating. Well, of course, I would feel that.
Sure.
The electromagnetism course I will do a year from now is really about electricity, magnetism, the forces there. In both of the courses, there is also some math involved. That when you do the physics track, you really should do well. At least the calculus course, and perhaps even a bit more. It is a field where math, it really is a useful and important tool.
Mm-hmm.
At the 300 level, the highest level, there also are two courses alternating. The course in particle physics, which is about elementary particles, the subatomic particles. So we go at a smaller scale, even in the quantum mechanics course. And the other course at the 300 level is the advanced physics course, which is a very broad and general meaning. And basically, it's a topics course. I cover some topics where we go a little bit deeper into some subject. I tend to do mechanics like at the 100 level, but then in a way in a slightly more sophisticated way, and there's other topics there as well. And perhaps that's just enough detail for now.
Yeah, it's a great start. It seems like you cover quite a lot, and you go quite in depth.
That is at liberal arts and science, always an important decision to make when you design a series of courses, because of course you can never offer the same amount of courses that you do when you do a full-time physics program, and that's also very much not the intention. But certainly in physics, there are a number of very key fundamental theories that we do cover, and we need to for students to be able to go do a master program and anything related. This is just knowledge that they need to have.
Mm-hmm.
And we manage to cover a good amount of the basics. Of course, what also is very important in physics, as in a lot of tracks, I'm sure I do, is, you know, the senior project. If this is really a field that you like, you can really dig into your personal interests a bit more in that year-long project, and you can dig deeper or broader or whatever it is to really get you ready for your master application.
Yeah, fair enough. And I mean, you touched on an important topic there, that it is physics within liberal arts and sciences.
Yeah.
So can you tell me a little bit about the kind of course combinations that you see your students make within other disciplines that we offer here?
Yeah. Well, I think I already touched upon the fact that mathematics is quite a common combination. Not only is mathematics a very useful and important tool to describe the world with physics, also the other way around. You know, in physics, we use some applications of mathematics that are not covered in the math courses. So even if you want to do a math master, some of the physics courses could be really interesting. Other combinations that are quite common are for instance, computer science, you know, modeling the world, the universe, whatever you want to do. There's also similar types of thinking also in the course. I do use at some point some computer programs to do some simulations. For instance, I don't rely heavily or at all, perhaps, on really computer programming skills, but the line of thinking is definitely there. Mm. And of course, also I have to mention engineering. There are a number of fields in engineering where some knowledge of physics is just expected. You know, whether it's mechanical engineering or electrical engineering, or you know, some of the other fields, sustainable materials, all those fields. You don't necessarily have to do the entire physics track, although I wouldn't mind if you did. But you know, pick and choose some courses that really will contribute to your mastery of that field, and again, get you ready for the master you want to do after UCR. So
it's dependent on what the student adds in, what direction he can go.
It's the point of liberal arts and science,
isn't it? Absolutely, yeah, it is.
We encourage students to really find a profile that fits their interests and ambitions. And there's plenty of profiles where a physics program or at least a single course would fit well in.
Absolutely. Now, say I were to be a student in your classes, what are the kind of assignments or projects that I can expect?
Yeah. In I think all my courses, there's a big emphasis on problem solving. Mm-hmm. So homework sets is something I do in every course, whether it's three or four homework sets over the semester, that depends a bit. But that you work on problems, try to find solutions, that is a very a common skill, I think not just at UCR, but worldwide. When I was an undergraduate, I remember the days and occasional nights with students, fellow student friends, just working through problems. And that's just part of the lifestyle, certainly. There are some exams as well where you also are, tested more individually, on some of these problems. But also, and this relates to liberal arts and science that you mentioned, I find it important, particularly here, that students learn to express and communicate about their field. So I have writing assignments in most of my courses, and sometimes they're quite modest, they can even be a single paragraph. Mm-hmm. Explain what an electric charge is, which is actually a very difficult thing to explain. But in my 300 level courses, I ask students to write a paper, and of course, in physics, it's not expected that you contribute original research. That's something you do perhaps in your master, but more likely when you do a PhD. Mm-hmm. But it is, of course, doing research is an important skill. So you definitely do practice that. I will give students papers, and they can be, from a Nobel Prize winner where he or she describes the work, or it is, a paper that just describes, how you can tackle perhaps a familiar problem, but in a more interesting way, or looking at particular applications that I like them to pursue. So I do want students to read up on the literature and also make their own contribution,
sure.
Even a small one. As I said, I'm now in the semester where I teach quantum mechanics, so maybe that as an example. I have a project here where I ask students to calculate. I need to introduce it a little bit before starting throwing out all the math words. So when you're looking at molecules, atoms, what is remarkable, they have very distinct energy levels. No, mm-hmm. They're quantized, hence quantum mechanics. And the energy levels that are allowed in a molecule or atom are very specific for that particle. In fact, it's a signature. You know,
right.
In much of chemical analysis, you can find what component are you holding by looking at, some way of what are the energy levels of that molecule. So what I do in this course, I give him a potential energy function, doesn't matter, every student a different one, and I just give him a technique to say, okay, this is how you solve the problem, this is how you find the energy levels.
Right.
So I describe how to do that, but then I ask at the end to write a paper about it. And this follows the basic scientific approach. You talk about what is your problem, what you're going to do. You describe what are the methods you are going to use. You talk about the results, what have you obtained. And then you look back on it. No, does this make sense? Are there anything unexpected? Is there something could do to do further research? But quite compact. This is not a paper of 20 pages. This should be, I don't know, 5 pages. So we'll see what I get handed in a few weeks. But that's what I have in mind.
Right. So from everything you're telling me today, it seems like students are well prepared, both skill wise and content wise, for masters. Can you, maybe you're still in touch with some of your former students? Can you tell a little bit about sort of the directions that students potentially could take after graduating?
Yeah, I myself come from the world of particle physics. Mm-hmm. That's why it's one of the 300 level courses. That's what I got my PhD in. And I certainly can tell that a number of our alumni have also gone in that field. I'm very happy to report. They've done masters and PhDs in Amsterdam, in various other universities abroad, whether it's in Edinburgh, whether it's in Manchester. I don't have a full list prepared, but there is several. Very interestingly, many have worked at CERN in Geneva, which is the great research laboratory for particle physics. That's where they do all the discoveries these days. It really is the place to be. And So it's been nice to see some of my students end up there as well. So that is a field that certainly is open to UCR students, of course, not only from doing my course, but with the package we described, some math, some computer science, whatever mm-hmm. It is. In addition to that, maybe I can also mention some of the more broader masters, because of course you can go into a field that is very specific and monodisciplinary, and that can be fabulous if that's what you're looking for. But of course there also are things like energy science, just to mention something which is this day quite important. When you talk about the energy transition and all the other things, and clearly the physics of solar cells, of wind turbines, But also much generally, how do you distribute energy? There's a lot of physics aspects to it, mm-hmm. but of course there's also engineering involved there. There also is just math, but also of course policy. You know, yeah. what rules or laws do you need to kind of organize this? So these broad masters is also where a number of students have gone into and also done quite well.
Right, and that seems a perfect fit indeed for doing physics at a liberal arts.
That's exactly in a way the perfect background for those students. That's right.
All right. Well, I think that covers about what I wanted to cover today. So thank you very much for sharing.
You're very welcome, Denise. It was fun to talk to you.